Hello everyone, and welcome back to my channel. I'm taking a much needed break from Skyrim to play a game that I just haven't been able to get out of my head because I've enjoyed it so much. It's Jonathan Blow's new puzzle game, The Witness. It's been out for a couple of months. I've played through it once or twice. I certainly don't have the solutions to the puzzles memorized or anything like that. I do know all the rules, so to speak, that the game communicates to you, but I'm going to try to give it a feel of natural sort of progression so that as I go through, if I encounter a puzzle that the game hasn't taught us to do yet, I'll skip it and come back to it later, much like I did on my first playthrough. I'm going to go for total completion, which means solving every panel, finding every environmental puzzle, finding all the audio logs, and watching all the videos. And you'll see what that's about later on. So I'm also not going to do anything the game hasn't taught me to do yet. So we can move with the arrow keys. Fair enough. Game starts. You just kind of open your eyes and you're in this big old tunnel. You approach here, the game tells you to left click, you draw the line to operate the panel, and the door opens. Pretty straightforward. Now, the environmental puzzles are extremely straightforward. They involve drawing lines. It's just a matter of being able to recognize them and sort of line them up to create the lines. The mechanic is actually a lot, it reminds me of when I played Batman Arkham Asylum and you had to line up the green question marks to solve Riddler puzzles. So as you can see, we've created a circle and line just like on the panel, and we can draw it there in the environment just like we were able to when we were interacting with the panel. Pretty cool. And I'm saying we already knew how to do that because we had done it with the panel. It's just a matter of that first time you notice the pattern out in the world and realize you can start the drawing mechanic anywhere, you start to see them everywhere and uncover these puzzles. So that's something you know how to do as soon as you do the first one. So let's open this second door. A very slightly more complicated line, but pretty basic nonetheless. And let's walk up and out of here into the introductory area. Now, let's explore a little bit. We've got a panel here, which, despite being a more complicated maze, is really the same bit of line drawing. You will notice on this one there are two particular starting points, and if you backtrack enough you realize you have to start in that one on the right if you want to open up the panel. Now this is getting into panels actually having effects in the world. I mean, those first two opened the door. This one, if you walk over and look at it, has flipped open one of three latches on this panel here at the laser gate. I don't know what it is about this game. Its reactions to it have been very, very mixed. Some people have hated it, some people have loved it. I'm in the latter camp. I love it. And I can't even really adequately describe why. It just, the best way I can think of is it almost feels like my brain is getting a massage. So if you look at this one, it's got one start, but it has two exit points. There's a cable running out through that tower window, and there's another one running back to the door. We'll start with the door cable to open another hatch. So just drive past, or draw, not drive, past the first endpoint, and hit that lower one instead. And as you can see, if we go back to the door, we'll see that the second of the three latches is now open. We've got a series of panels here, but before we do that, there's another environmental puzzle. You can see right up here between the cloud and the wall. So we'll solve that one. Always fun. Now let's do this panel, which is, again, pretty simple line drawing. Takes us over to this panel. Again, simple line drawing. You can ignore all the extraneous stuff because it's just a single start point, single end point. Which activates this cable, unlocks another panel, which is more complicated yet, but still, same mechanic. Simple line drawing, single start point, single end point. And with that one on, the third and final hatch should be open. Latch should be opened. But there's another thing you can notice before you leave here. And that is that this pillar is also actually a solvable puzzle. If you look at it, it's got these triangle symbols on it. We haven't really been trained yet in what those mean, so I'm going to leave it be for now. We'll come back once I'm comfortable with the statement that we have learned those rules, which won't actually be too long. I'm starting a backlog so I know the unsolved puzzles I've left behind to come back to. In the meantime, I will note that if you're really paying attention, you can see an environmental puzzle there. That's the one that unlocks. That's one you're not meant to notice on your first playthrough, I'm pretty darn certain. So we'll leave it until we come back later anyway. Now this one, for the moment, we can just take any path we want, and it will shut down that laser gate. And we're free to exit this opening fort, although we certainly haven't done everything there is to be done here. Let's head out. The game now teaches us that we're able to sprint with the shift key, which is neat. Before I leave, now that the gate is open, let me switch this cable over. You'll be able to see what it did very shortly. Note that we've closed that hatch, or reclosed that latch, so we can't interact with that panel anymore. The path here is obvious, but let's hug the wall of the fort instead, the entrance fort, to find some other stuff. If we head this way, we can solve another environmental puzzle. You can see the path makes a pretty straightforward circle line pattern all the way there to the end. And if we head back this way now, the other thing we can do is start collecting audio logs. There are three here in and around the entrance fort. The first is here, right above where we came out of the tunnel.
Through many births, I have wandered on and on, searching for, but never finding, the builder of this house.
While we're up here, note that there's another environmental puzzle right there. That one's pretty straightforward. And if we loop around the wall over here, we can see another audio log there on top of the laser gate.
I am standing on the threshold about to enter a room. It is a complicated business. In the first place, I must shove against an atmosphere pressing with a force of 14 pounds on every square inch of my body. I must make sure of landing on a plank, traveling at 20 miles a second around the sun, a fraction of a second too early or too late, the plank would be miles away. I must do this whilst hanging from a round planet head outward into space and with a wind of ether blowing at no one knows how many miles a second through every interstice of my body. The plank has no solidity of substance. To step on it is like stepping on a swarm of flies. Shall I not slip through? No. If I make the venture, one of the flies hits me and gives me a boost up again. I fall again and am knocked upwards by another fly, and so on. I may hope that the net result will be that I remain about steady, but if, unfortunately, I should slip through the floor or be boosted too violently up to the ceiling, the occurrence would be not a violation of the laws of nature, but a rare coincidence. The minor difficulties. I ought really to look at the problem four-dimensionally as concerning the intersection of my world line with that of the plank. Then again, it is necessary to determine in which direction the entropy of the world is increasing in order to make sure that my passage over the threshold is an entrance, not an exit. Verily, it is easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle than for a scientific man to pass through a door. And whether the door be barn door or church door, it might be wiser that he should consent to be an ordinary man and walk in, rather than wait till all the difficulties involved in a really scientific ingress are resolved. Arthur Eddington, 1927.
All right. And the game is all about nonverbal communication. So if we continue to track the wall, we will see first the gate that cable opened when we rerouted it. If we head through here, we will run up against another puzzle door. That we really haven't been taught how to open yet. We don't know what these symbols mean, so I'm going to leave it for now. Come back when I can fairly say that we've solved enough tutorial puzzles to get what the game is trying to have us do. We head all the way back, get back on the path, this time we'll follow it. Note that it forks, right or left. Let's head left. We've got this door, which has more symbols we don't really recognize, haven't been trained to open yet. So, I'll head this way. This set of green panels. Now this is a tutorial teaching us about how to, what to do with, say, the green door panel with the dots we saw earlier. So if I go this way, The red dot blinks, and it doesn't work. If I go this way, that dot blinks, it doesn't work. So what this is telling me is that I need, whatever path I draw, needs to hit every dot, as well as connecting the two points. And then it works. So let's try it with this one. There we go. Just need to hit all the dots in whatever pattern we're given. Oops, that's not right. Neither is that. I need to start here. Nope, that can't be it. It's always obvious when you finally it always seems obvious once you finally spot it. Until then, it's like, what? That it can't be that one. Because that forecloses every exit, so it's got to be this one. There we go. Found it. Now, what about you? Let's start here. Just do this. Alright, so we know how to solve those now. Which means, let's look at this one. The symbols inside the squares are still foreign, so we don't know how to solve that one. We haven't seen the triangles on the pillar yet, so we don't know how to solve it. But we do know how to solve this gate we saw back here. Let's go take care of it right quick. A little more complicated, but we know what we need to do. Connect everything while covering every dot. And just like that, it's done. Opens the gate, where there's another audio log.
Of all the communities available to us, there's not one I would want to devote myself to, except for the Society of True Searchers, which has very few living members at any time. Albert Einstein, 1924.
All right, and there are two other things in here. The first is this panel just sitting on the ground. See that triangle symbol? Let's see if we can decipher the rule from this. It's a tutorial. That didn't work, and it made the triangle blink. Same with that. It made the triangle blink. So this one, it's simple enough that you just kind of have to solve it through trial and error. Going over here will never do us any good. Now that one works. And so there are other ways the game teaches this to you. There are many of these stray panels that you'll find throughout the game, but what it really is, you can already decipher the rule. If you think of the box around the triangle, the number of triangles is the number of highlightable sides. So when I go this way, I'm hitting two sides of the one triangle box, so it doesn't work. Same is true here. I'm hitting three sides of a one triangle box. If I go this way, I'm only covering one side of the one triangle box, and it works. So Let's solve this second puzzle first. trying to remember. Yeah, that's not going to work. Same stupid one I just tried. Bam! There it is. We open another side gate, which just spits us back out onto this main path. Now, I'll just tell you that eventually we want to come back here, and by eventually I mean at the very, very end. So, and we'll, in contrast, we'll never have any real need to go through those side gates again. So, we want to leave this one with the first solution, with all three latches open. So if you play around with that stray panel over there, that's sufficient to decipher the triangle rule. So now we can go ahead and solve this pillar puzzle, which I think is just oodles of fun. So first, you want to run past, you can see there are just two single triangle columns, and that's all that we really have. So that covers that whole set of triangles. We already have the very bottom one covered, so let's get the next two this way, let's get the rest of the column this way, and then connect to the exit. This should work. And in fact, it does. And what that reveals to us is a floor puzzle over in here, which is of the hexagon type we've already seen, but the other thing to notice, and it can be very hard to see, is that there's a circle and line over here, but it dead ends. We can see an end point over here, so let's try this. No. We've made a line. Let's see if it works. It doesn't. This is kind of tough to figure out, but if we skip, well, we can't skip that one. If we skip one of the hexagons and connect it, you will notice that the failure color is yellow, and then we can connect all the way to the end to solve our environmental puzzle. Yeah, it's pretty crazy, I know. And then, because we do know the hexagon rule, we can go ahead and peacefully actually solve this puzzle. Doesn't really matter, you can go with any one of the exit points. And we can move on. So next up is going to be another nice row of tutorial panels and an audio log to go with them. The audio log is tucked away back here, so let's listen to it.
The physicist Wolfgang Pauli once spoke of two limiting conceptions, both of which have been extraordinarily fruitful in the history of human thought, although no genuine reality corresponds to them. At one extreme is the idea of an objective world, pursuing its regular course in space and time, independently of any kind of observing subject. This has been the guiding image of modern science. At the other extreme is the idea of a subject, mystically experiencing the unity of the world and no longer confronted by an object or by any objective world. This has been the guiding image of Asian mysticism. Thinking moves somewhere in the middle, between these two limiting conceptions. We should maintain the tension resulting from these two opposites. Werner Heisenberg, 1974.
And we've got another nice row of panels to teach us a new rule. We go straight through. It works. Interesting. Apparently that ran afoul of it, and that worked. So what you can pretty quickly discern is that when you see these symbols, you need to keep the different colors separate. Racism is alive and well, we need to keep black and white away from each other. Which carries over to this one, and 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 this one. And finally, this one. And note that this one shows you one other important thing. You don't need to make sure that they're all in the same section. As you can see, we've got two different sections of black dots, and it worked. So the only thing to really bear in mind is keeping them separate. With that in mind, if we return to this other door we skipped, now we know what all this means. There are four starting points. And I happen to have done this enough times. So now obviously we need to combine both rules. We need to cover every hexagon and fully separate the black squares from the white squares. So we'll just keep on drawing a nice little line around the black squares. I think I'm doing this one wrong. Hold on. So if I look at that, we've covered every hexagon. There's no section sharing between white and black squares. And sure enough, the door opens. If we head through here, got a pretty simple box opener, and it has a blueprint on it. We haven't really seen a good place to draw that blueprint yet. So we're basically done for now, and we can move on. You can really wander anywhere you want to from this point. The island we're on is divided into somewhat recognizable sections. Like I said, if I come across... Well, even though I already know the puzzle rules and am vaguely familiar just because I've solved most of them before, I'm going to try and keep it to something of a natural progression feel. So I got this building right here with these cool rock formations, but if you look down here, What you see, or should be learning to spot, is an opportunity to create another symbol. Although, strangely, we're blocked off by some kind of black gunk that I can't seem to properly line up to get rid of. Well, maybe the gunk's not the problem. I might have my FOV too high. It defaults to 90. Let's put it back there and see if that works any better. Well, no, that's not fixing shit. I'm sure there's some kind of sweet spot. I've read about people having these particular bugs. Let's try 97. I read something about that being a sweet spot earlier. Doesn't really seem to be doing much for me, though. Would a bigger one help? Or does it need to be even smaller? It's just about getting it lined up right. Maybe 100. Let's try that. It's not the black gunk isn't the problem, it's just I can't seem to line it up. And I know I'm supposed to be able to, which is the part that's kind of bothering me. Alright, time for a quick Google about FOV settings. I just need a moment. In the meantime, while this, my internet struggles mightily, as it so often does, let's head to the other side of the roof, where there's another stray panel designed to teach us the triangle rule. This time, as you can hopefully see, we've got a two triangle box. And sure enough, if I cover two sides as I go by, it works. Looks like the magic FOV setting is 105. Let's see if that fixes the problem. Could also be my resolution. Let's try 1080. Thank you. Something isn't working. Ten-eighty's not working. I'm not even sure what vignetting is. Maybe if I turn off VSync. No? It's just not quite drawing the little Joker tall enough for me. I go. And this is the key. Peeking through this hole while you do it. And I just can't get it connected. I've never had this problem. And I've done this at least a couple of times. Maybe if I disable multi-sampling. Nope, that's not doing it either. It's just making things look worse. Let's drop res a little more. Let's try 720. Ooh, that's ugly. It's ugly and it doesn't work. Well, what the hell? Okay, hold on. Matter of getting the right angle most of the time, but this go-round, it's not working for me. Well, let's crank everything back to max. Maybe the key is to change my... viewing angle. That just seems to make the gap problem even worse. I'm not just gonna leave without solving this, cause come on. It's just not how I roll. Thank you. Just can't ever seem to eliminate that gap, can I? Well, damn. Alright, let me try something else. I'll make note of that in my backlog and come back to it. We head back down here, and we head through here. We're just, we're at the entrance to that same building. And we can open this door. Which winds up being pretty straightforward, and also winds up teaching us about the next, puzzle mechanic. I was hoping I'd be able to change something. It looks like that splotch is there to stay. There's got to be a way to do this. When I played this on the... Here comes some sacrilege, but when I first played this, it was... Well, what the hell? Now it's just working? I don't get it. What changed? Whatever. I don't even care what changed. Actually, I can even see. I think it was a shadow. Apparently, you have to have the door open. Who knew? That's just how detailed this shit can be. Pretty crazy, I know. Anyway. Let's head back over here now. Head inside. And start solving some more puzzles. Who doesn't love solving puzzles? Well, you'd better if you're going to play this game. I feel like there's more to it than that. I feel so weirdly absorbed when I'm playing. So, as you can see, we're drawing two lines now. And whichever one I focus on, a mirror image is created on the other side. That's... Every area kind of has a theme, so that symmetry is going to be the theme for this one. So I need to make sure that whatever direction I go, I'm able to connect both lines from the start point to the end point. Which for the moment is pretty easy. But obviously some complications are going to be introduced as we go. And if you can't really see what I'm doing, don't worry. As long as you understand the rule, it's pretty easy to do this yourself. So, we've opened the wall. Looks like whatever this is isn't powered on yet. And we also lit up a cable going this way, which runs right here to the kiln in this pottery building. So the, introducing some different geometry to the mix, if nothing else. These are all still pretty simple. Although, we're running into a bit of a complication here, as you can see. Can't go that way. Can't do that. Can't do that. Ah, there we go. I need to be willing to switch my exit target. So we've lit another cable, so let's jog over here. Get started on the next batch. Can't go straight up. Can't go that way. That works. And now the, if you look closely, you'll see that the solution is the same as the last one, despite the, panel getting a little warped by that, melt action. And then this one is really distorted, but your ability to spot that the solution was the same will pay dividends on the melted one as well. And we lit up another cable, so let's follow it out. Follow it all the way up to here. Over this neat arch to this new set of trees. Now look at this, this is the first of the obelisks we found. These show you the environmental puzzles you've solved. So you might recognize the one that we solved, that we had so much trouble solving, but ultimately did back in the pottery hut. It's the only one we've solved on here. You can see some more that are represented, but apparently undiscovered. Let's head up here to this gate, which returns us to the hexagon rule we're already familiar with. And we get it open, we head on through, and the there's several things to do now. First, I'm going to grab another audio log, if it'll allow me to. It's trying to make me go to the panel.
Formerly, you appeared to me, O Lord, as invisible by every creature because you are a hidden, infinite God. Infinity, however, is incomprehensible by every means of comprehending. Later, you appeared to me as visible by all. For a thing exists only as you see it, and it would not actually exist unless it saw you. For your vision confers being, since your vision is your essence. Thus, my God, you are equally invisible and visible. As you are invisible. As the creature is, which exists only in so far as the creature sees you, you are visible. You, therefore, my invisible God, are seen by all, and in all sight you are seen by everyone who sees. You who are invisible, who are both absolute from everything visible and infinitely super exalted, are seen in every visible thing and in every act of vision. Therefore, I must leap across this wall of invisible vision to where you are to be found. But this wall is both everything and nothing. For you, who confront as if you were both all things and nothing at all, dwell inside that high wall which no natural ability can scale by its own power. Nicholas of Cusa, 1453.
All right, let's solve some more puzzles. So this one combines the symmetry rule we've been learning with the hexagon rule we're already familiar with. This is pretty basic. We just need to make sure that whatever else we do, we hit every single hexagon with at least one of our two lines. And it lights up another cable. Let's follow that one to our next row of panels, which introduces another facet. Now we have two colored lines and two colored hexagons. This also winds up being fairly basic. We just need to make sure that the correct colored line gets the correct hexagon. Which means and the one that we start with will be the blue line. So we just need to make sure. And as this one shows us, we can retain neutral hexagons, which can be covered by either line, so long as, in the end, we're sure we get both. And we light up another set of cables. Cool. Let's follow these. To the next set of panels. We found an audio log here before, but now the panel's actually on and we're ready to solve it. That's not right. Let's try this. You'll notice that the yellow line on that one is starting to fade. On this one, it's even more faded. That didn't work. Let's try this instead. You can still just barely see it on this one. And now this one, it's gone. But we've learned the rule. We have learned that, well, I'm surprised that didn't work, actually. Ah, because the yellow one wasn't connected with an endpoint there. So we've got a yellow one mirroring our movements here. Let's do this. No. Let's do this. Oops. And so the yellow one there, while in my mind it was going like this, I think what actually... Well, yeah, now I'm not even sure. Because they should have crossed, but... Maybe it went a different way. Maybe it went like that somehow. So far it's been an exact mirror image every time. At least when you have two. This one went... I went left, it went right. I went up, it went up. And this one, obviously, I went up and it went down. I went left and it went right. I went down and it went up. So, I'm not sure how to tell whether it's going to do a partial or a full mirroring when I do movements. Regardless, let's just try and track our yellow one. So if I go 1, 2, 3 over, and then through, it should have hit it. And then if I curl back, I should be able to just stair step to get mine and make an exit. And even though I can't see it, even though it's invisible, I've covered the yellow dot and it works. Let's do the same thing here. Let's go all the way over to the fourth. Cut through. Let's go back 2. Down 1. Over 1. Down 1 and out. That should have all 3 covered, even though it's invisible. And sure enough, it does. Thank goodness. Now there's a bit more to do here. We've got an environmental puzzle to solve before we follow that cable. If we head down here, you can see 2 pretty clearly. There's one that's not connected from our current vantage, but its reflection down in the water is easily doable right now. So we'll go ahead and handle it. Now there's an interesting set of panels down here. They don't open anything, but they're a tutorial in paying attention to the environment. So if we get on this panel, this one's very straightforward. You can see the rocks and their reflections perfectly outline the correct path to draw. Let's go to the second one, which, even though they're now partially obscured, still does the same thing. You can't see the actual rock, but you can see its reflection. And then you can't see the reflections, but you can see the actual rocks guiding you in how to draw the path on that second panel. Now let's go to the next one, which is a little bit tougher yet in that it doesn't actually line up with the panel and we have to reason it out. But if you look at the rocks we can see, they basically go, if you think of it in, if you think of the grid as being, you can basically be at level 1, level 2, or at level 3. If you look at the rocks, you can see it goes 2, 1, 3, 2. So let's go 2, 1, 3, 2, out. And sure enough, it works. If we look at the next one, they aren't even as cleanly together as we might like. You have to account for depth perception, but it's pretty obviously 1, 2, 3, 1. I'm sorry. These fit right into the grid. You just have to follow them even when the symmetry is off because of depth perception. And finally, we head over to this one, which we've just unlocked. Looking through here, you can't really see anything. This teaches us another thing that'll come into play several times. The panels are operable from both sides. If we come at it backwards, suddenly we're able to see the path very clearly drawn out by the palm trees. And it works. And I think I mentioned that doesn't actually unlock anything. That's just to teach us to pay attention to the environment. A lesson the game will reinforce in other ways many more times as we play through. So, when we solved that third row of panels, we lit another cable, which if we follow, takes us to this second gate, which is now operable. We've got basic hexagon rule with symmetry in play, which is nice. While we're up here, before we ascend to that very top platform, if we head back here, we've got another audio log.
One nature, perfect and pervading, circulates in all natures. One reality, all comprehensive, contains within itself all realities. The one moon reflects itself wherever there is a sheet of water, and all the moons in the waters are embraced within the one moon. The absolute of all the Buddhas enters into my own being, and my own being is found in union with theirs. The inner light is beyond praise and blame. Like space, it knows no boundaries. Yet it is even here, within us, ever retaining its serenity and fullness. It is only when you hunt for it that you lose it. You cannot take hold of it, but equally you cannot get rid of it. And while you can do neither, it goes on its own way. You remain silent, and it speaks. You speak, and it is dumb. The great gate of charity is wide open, with no obstacles before it. Yung Cha Tashi, circa 700.
All right. Now, one other thing before we ascend to that top platform. If we look over here, we now have the right perspective for that environmental puzzle we saw earlier. And now that we've kind of seen the obelisk, you can see that when we solve one of those and that energy shoots out, it goes to the obelisk and lights up that particular pattern. So we finished one side of this one, which is exciting. And let's head up here. One last set of panels next to a yellow box. Now this one is blank. This one looks pretty straightforward. Now we only have a yellow laser, which is interesting, or a yellow line, but we've learned, or should have learned by now, that the rule is symmetry. So we need to create, what this is asking us to do is create a mirror image with the blue line for this final set of panels. So let me just go up to, over, down, all the way over, up to, left to, zigzag. So up to, over one, down to, all the way over, up to, over to, zigzag, and out. And it works and it lights the next one. Well, let's do this one. Simple hexagon rule in play here, but creating the mirror image is not so easy. Over, down, over, up, okay. Over, down, over, up, then we cut backwards, and then solve. Let's do this last one. Which actually turns out to be pretty simple. It's in, down, over, up, over, down, over, up. But pay attention, as you'll notice the exit point is moved. It was up over there, it's down over here, which means we need to create a bidirectional mirror image. So our zigzag needs to start off going up instead of down. Otherwise, it's exactly the same, and we power on a simple switch, which will activate the first of 11 lasers that are scattered around the island and kind of represent our overarching goal in solving all these puzzles. I'll wait for the laser to fully turn on, but we've been going approximately a full hour, so I think this first laser actually turns out to be a pretty good stopping point. As soon as it finishes powering on, so there, at this point, there are really only a couple of things I've left behind me, which I won't be able to even really adequately know or there until the very end of the game. So you can see the laser is reflecting onto that mountain way off in the distance. And that's where we're going to leave it. So, next thing I do will probably be another Skyrim video. I don't know, I can't get this game out of my head because I love it so much. I just really, really, really enjoy playing it. It keeps me very relaxed the entire time. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed this little diversion. If not, be comforted in the fact that we'll be able to get through the whole thing in 4 or 5 videos. So, and then get back after a nice break to finish up Skyrim. Hopefully, it'll finally let me find those Dawnguard agents sooner rather than later. Until then, thank you so much for watching. If you enjoy my videos, please consider clicking an ad, liking, sharing, or subscribing, any or all of which really help me out. Regardless, please know that I really appreciate the time you spend watching, and hope you have a fantastic day. Bye-bye.